Good morning, students. Myself, Dr. Vijender Singh Tawar, Associate Professor in English. Presently, I have been posted at Government College, Buda. In the series of video lecture which I am delivering, today's lecture is meant for Class BA Part 3rd and subject as usual, English Literature, Paper 1st. The name of the poem is The Election. It was composed by Sitakant Mahapatra. Sitakant Mahapatra is a well-known name in India. He comes from Odisha. He was born in 1937. And he is regarded as one of the most famous post-colonial writer from Odisha. In his writings, he tries to go against the trend of romanticizing the past, and instead he focuses on the reality and the presence of movement. He has been honored by many institutions. He has been awarded Bharatiya Gyanpith Award, the highest award for literature in India, in 1993. He has also been awarded Sahitya Academy Award in 1974. And in 2001, he was awarded the award of highest honor by Soka University of Tokyo, Japan. He is regarded as a versatile genius. In him, we can find the roles of an academician, researcher, administrator, translator, poet, and critic. He has described in his poems the poverty and hunger which ravage the villages of Odisha and cause starvation death. He is a poet of post-colonial India, you can say. Now about this poem. The poem entitled The Election is one of the most talked about poems of Sitakant Mahapatra. It was originally written in Odia language and then the poet himself translated it into English. The poem is based on the post-colonial disillusionment that when we were trying to get rid of colonial rule, we had certain dreams. And when we entered into post-colonial era, we realized that all the dreams which we dreamt when we were fighting for against the colonial rule have not been fulfilled. So this is called post-colonial disillusionment. And one such dream was of democracy, that in democracy, all people will be equal, there will be no difference between rich and poor, there will be no difference on the basis of caste, creed, etc. But all these dreams were not realized in post-colonial India. In this poem, a politician is the narrator of the poem, who has come to campaign for the votes in a remote part or in remote villages of Odisha state. The poem is actually a satire on the rule of people in India. In the beginning, we find that the poet has criticized the politician. But when we move towards the end of the poem, we realize that the criticism moves from the rulers to the commoners, and failure of democracy is revealed by the poet. Actually, the poet has presented a real picture of the poverty-stricken people of Odisha. They suffer from hunger and starvation. Deaths also take place in their villages. However, at the time of election, they exercise their right to vote in spite of despair in their lives, although they do so for some consideration. That is, they sell their votes just to satisfy their temporary needs. This is a satire how the voters are not in a position to choose right, but they are surrounded by, or they are trapped in a system in which they cannot do anything. Now let us come to the poem. The poem is a very short poem. It consists of 5 stanzas. Here we have to concentrate on each word and each line so that we can draw what is the message given by the poet in this poem. Let me make you 2 things clear. In this poem, there are 2 persons. First person, that is our, has been used, and your second person has been used. As we, or particularly myself, I have decided to interpret the poem keeping in view that the narrator of the poem is the politician. So our is used for the politician and your for the villagers. This is to be kept in mind while interpreting this poem. That is, our means the speaker, the narrator, and he stands for the politicians, and your for the common people or the villagers or the residents of that remote area where that politicians go for his campaign. Now see that our jeep crawls to your village. Crawls means move very slowly, with very slow speed. Your village means the village of the voters where he has come for campaigning. Seeking, then trying to find strange melodies. Melodies, music, musical tunes. Now look, why the word strange has been used. In villages, such kind of scenes which are seen during the election period are very uncommon, very strange. That jeeps are moving very fast, they are playing musical tunes, they are shouting slogans, and they are promoting certain things. These are very strange because they rarely happens in villages. From the roaring sun, roaring means burning sun in the very heat. It is very summer season, you can say. The common will, both of the speaker and the listener, that is politician and the villagers, both have common will. And I have interpreted it as a democracy. Both want that there should remain democracy. From the crisscross, that is going here and there with the lines crossing each other. Geometry of private agonism, personal, external, mental, and physical suffering. Now, let us come to the explanation of this stanza. In the first stanza, that is which just we have read, the narrator, that is the politician, says to the villagers that the jeep of politicians crawl on the road to reach them, to attract their attention. The jeep does not run but crawls. It indicates that the conditions of the roads is very bad. They are not in a good position. The rallies of politicians are accompanied by music, applause, noise, hooting, etc., which is quite strange as such things rarely happen in the villages, particularly under the burning sun, that is in the summer season when it is very hot. All this happens for the sake of the common will, that is democracy, which is very important in India. As we have seen that whether there is corona or any kind of disease, but politics and election, they must take place. As we have seen in Maharashtra, Uddhav Thackeray's election took place even when the situation was very worse or very bad in Maharashtra. Now in Bihar, there is going to be election. The politician forces the villagers to acknowledge the problems and difficulties he has faced by traveling to their village on crisscross geometry, that is irregular and rough roads. Now see, the politician is supposed to give good roads to people, but the roads are not good. They are very bad. It is very difficult to travel on such roads. So the politician feels, instead of feeling sorry that he has not been able to give the people good roads, he is making the people to acknowledge that he is taking great pains while working on those roads. If we go deeper into the words, we find how politicians who were supposed to be the servants of the public ironically become their masters and vice versa. Thus, now that democracy has made them masters, their living to a comfort zone for the people would be a kind of gratitude on people. Now stanza second. The poet says, our dark longings don't touch you. Longings, ulterior hidden motives or intense desires. Ulterior is existing beyond what is obvious or admitted, unintentionally hidden. Nor our trappings, all the things that are part of or a typical of a job that an company to hold in traps in order to attract somebody. Or posters, symbols, speeches, handbills, for your grief outlives empires. Grieving sorrow, problems, conditions outlives, surpasses, go beyond the empires. What the poet wants to say is this, in this second stanza, the politician says that the villagers are not affected by the dark longings, that is, their ulterior hidden motives. The politician have their motives which are hidden. The villagers very well know them, but they are not affected by them. Neither the hard work done by politicians on poster making, symbol campaigning, speeches, the handbills, etc., to trap the voters, attract them, because the voters have their own sorrows and grievances that surpass the issues of the states. The idea is, voters very well know their problems and they very well understand that their problems are not going to be solved. Their problems will remain for eternal times. Empires will come and go, but their problems will not be solved. But the irony is this, however, it is the grievances of the commoners that help him to gain power. That is, politician gain power because of the problems of the common people. The politician emotionally triggers their problems, that I will do this, that, etc., to gain that favor and ultimately succeed in gaining votes as well. Now stanza third. The cold grandchildren awaken in your heart as you discern, see, muted allegories. Muted means which are dumb, which are not spoken. And we know an allegory is an extended metaphor. In the songs and speeches, there is a wide use of rhetoric or of symbols and comparisons to convey an ideal end without explicitly stating or which are dimly perceived. On our Asian faces, Asian means like S's, dark our faces. In this is third stanza, the narrator says that cold children, what is the meaning of first? Let us understand cold children. That they have admitted that their problems will not be solved. Empires will come, empires will go, but they will remain in the same condition forever. that the problems, the suffering, such as starvation, death, etc., they have caused in the past, they are causing in the present, and they will cause in the future also. So they have lost their children in the past, and they have also lost all kinds of hopes. And because of this, they have killed desires in their hearts, as they know well that their condition will never be changed. That is desire to improve. They do not have any hope. They are pessimist. However, they have hope in their hearts that their future generation, that is their coming generation, may be able to live in a better way. This makes them look on the face of a politician which is tired and as he has left his comfort zone for the sake of votes. What is the meaning? Meaning is that the villagers, they look in the eyes of their leaders that they will bring good days for their coming generation. They do not do themselves anything to bring about the change. This is the problem. And as I have told in the first stanza also, that these leaders, they used to live in their AC rooms, but because it is now election, so they have come out and they are facing some problems and their faces are becoming dark. That is why the poet has used the AC faces, because they have left their comfort zone for the sake of votes. These people believe that these leaders have some magical powers. They can do anything for them. But as far as they themselves concerned, they do not do anything to bring the change on their own, but instead put their hopes on the politicians, and they remain in the same condition for eternity. Now stanza number fourth. Here the great persuaders, meaning I have given the slide, people who can convince or cause somebody to believe something, that is persuader, are little things but of no importance. That is the persuader. Who are persuader here? The politicians who persuade them that if they will vote for him or his party, they will do this thing or that thing. These are of no importance for the people. They think that these are just only speeches, nothing more than that. And not so hidden, neither it is hidden for the people that these politicians have their hidden issues. They very well know that these politicians, when they will win, they will do corruption. Cheap plastic, cheaper nylon, dark glasses to blot out the sun. Blot out means to hide, to cover something. And these words, cheaper plastic, these are the symbols of ordinary things, temporary solutions. We can say that in this stanza, fourth stanza, the narrator has exposed the real face of democracy in India. According to him, it is not hidden, but the very common fact, which is very well known to both the parties, that in such remote areas, the politicians need not to do something big and extraordinary for the votes, but providing cheap things like plastic, nylon, glasses, so during the campaign period will do. What is the meaning? Means the politician very well know that they also know their what they will do, and politician also know what the villagers will do. So they do not try to give the solution to the permanent problems such as social inequality, poverty, starvation. The politician do not try to eradicate such problems. On the contrary, they give them some money which will last for few days, and then their condition will be same. So politicians thus succeed to blot out the sun. That is, they deviate the people from the development and welfare by giving away the cheap goods only during the campaign. That is for temporary solution. Thus, anti-democracy comes into existence. Now the stanza, last stanza of the poem. With one foot in hunger, that is, they are in a very bad conditions. They are dying of starvation. That is, their immediate need is to get food. And the other in the soul, that is, their desire is to get good things for the future. That is, social issues such as they should have the health, education, roads, such kind of facilities should be given to them. Means they have two kinds of option. First is, they are suffering, they are dying of hunger. Their immediate need is, you can say, food. And in the long run, they think that democracy should bring about a change in their life. They should provide, they should be provided health facilities, education facilities, social equality, etc., etc. So they are in, you can say, dilemma of between these two things. And between these two, they, you make your decision. They have to make the decision. As they are hungry, their immediate requirement is very strong. So there is a pain, they cannot make the second choice. And that is why the poet is called Choice of Anguish. On paper they have choice, but in reality they do not have choice. So in detail we can say, in the last skanda, the narrator describes the failure of democracy caused not by the politician, but by the commoners. The people on the one hand become selfish in their demands and ask for livelihood. That is food, that is their temporary things, which can, their temporary requirements should be fulfilled, that is enough for them, to the rulers at any cost. On the other hand, they talk about soulful things like basic rights, social change, eradication of poverty, etc., etc. They cannot decide to which side they should go and ultimately fail in making the right decision. That is, in dilemma, they cannot take the right decision. Their immediate requirements become so strong that they forget about the social change, betterment of life, etc. Such issues are forgotten by them. Thus, social issues like inequality, class divide, poverty are not because of politicians, but because of the choice of people. Hence, the narrator explained how a task like election, which was meant for the welfare of people and which could bring about a change in the country, becomes a major task of corruption and malpractices. The idea is, they do not have any choice in reality. They are between, or they are in dilemma between two things. They have to choose two things. Their immediate requirement is, they are suffering from many things. They are dying of hunger. They require food. And the second thing is, they require that they should do certain things which bring about a change in the society. There should be health facility, education facilities, and other facilities should be given to them. They have to choose one thing, but their immediate, that is to satisfy their hunger, is so strong that they take the right decision. They become satisfied by specifying or satisfying their immediate needs, and they do the wrong decision. They choose the wrong path, and because of this right, wrong decision, their problems never come to an end. Thank you very much.